good morning, everyone, and we're so happy and blessed that you decided to join us this morning. The Lord bless you. My name is Pastor Jason, and I'm the lead pastor here at Fresh Wind, and we are coming at you live this morning. And this is my friend John. He's on bass, and Anamika's at the back on the computer, and we are blessed to be here. And would you do me a favor? Would you be willing to just go ahead and share this service to your Facebook page? And this will help get our service out there a little bit more widely. And you could help us out with that. That would be great. Also, make sure that you get yourself a piece of bread or a cracker and some juice. A little bit later on, we're going to be celebrating communion together. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for this day which you've given to us, and we just give this service into your hands. We ask, God, that you would anoint, that you would take over, and that the name of Jesus would be uplifted and glorified. Lord, we surrender our wills to your will today. I pray for all watching, God, that that they would feel your presence today. Lord, I pray over the technology that the stream would go great and, again, that your name would be uplifted and glorified. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's worship the Lord together.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. These are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. Though these are days of great trials, of famine, darkness, and sorrow, still we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on clouds, shining like the sun, and a trumpet call, lift your voice, is the ear of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming his flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding the temple of praise. These are the days of the harvest, the fields are as wide in the world, and we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes,
that you're worshiping at home along with us. And would you do me a favor, if you have your family around you, just give each other a big hug this morning. Tell them how much you love them. Today is a special day. It is Valentine's Day. So happy Valentine's Day to you all. Lord bless you.
Anywhere among us, we welcome you.
Father, you are such a great God. We love you this morning, and we praise you in the highest. Your name is higher than any other name, and you're such an amazing, amazing God. It's our honor and our privilege to serve you. Amen. Says that there's no other name under heaven by which men can be saved. Only in Jesus Christ. There's no other religion. There's no political leader. There's no way we could ever work our way to God. We have to come through Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And it's our privilege to be able to worship Him and serve Him today. And we're going to get our hearts prepared for the Lord's Supper. We're going to do that in just a few moments after our announcements. This is a beautiful song written by Paul Baloche and Lenny LeBlanc. I had the privilege of several years ago of going to Darien Lake for Kingdom Bound, and hung out on a Saturday in the worship tent, and Lenny LeBlanc was doing a concert there. And right after he played his first song, which was by Soundtrack, all the power went out. And there were no backup generators. And so he went and grabbed his guitar and he sat down in a chair, and the very next song that he sang was a song that he said he had been working on with his buddy Paul. And this was the song they played. And I'll tell you, the anointing of God fell so strong in that worship tent. There were no lights, it was just daylight. But we got a sense of the awesomeness of God, this sacrifice that Jesus made. He did it with us in mind. He put us above all else and laid down His life. What a great Savior we serve.
Trampled on. you took the fall. You thought of me above all, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall. You thought of me above all. Like a rose trampled on the ground, you took the fall. Thought of me above all.
Hallelujah. Folks, just lift your hands towards heaven this morning and give Him praise and thanksgiving and glory. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. 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 Lord bless you. If you just take a moment to watch a couple of announcements, and we'll be right back at you to do communion together. Lord bless you. Of God. Amen. Amen. Well, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning at verse 23. It says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" This is not an empty church ritual. This is an ordinance of the church, a direct command of Jesus Christ himself, that we do this in remembrance of him. And when we do this, we play a part in proclaiming Jesus Christ crucified and resurrected to the world. So this isn't just a ritual this morning, it is a proclamation. Then there's some caveats, some stipulations. "Therefore, whoever eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. And that is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep." as someone who regularly proclaims the word of God, that is a very tough passage at the end. When it talks about people who have gotten sick because they have not recognized the body and blood of the Lord properly, partaking of these emblems, and it also says many have fallen asleep. This is very, very important to the Lord, that we approach this with a proper attitude, a proper heart. It's not only that we have been born again and that we acknowledge Jesus Christ as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's the first prerequisite. The second is that we have to approach this with a proper heart. If we have unconfessed sin in our lives, this is a great opportunity to quietly confess those to the Lord. It says a person ought to examine himself before they eat of the bread and drink of the cup. Why don't we just take a moment and do that? If there's anything in our lives that shouldn't be there, let's just confess those quietly to the Lord this morning. Maybe you're in a state of a bad relationship with another brother or sister in Christ or family member. It's a great opportunity right now to make things right, to admit your part in it, and to say that you're sorry. That's an honorable and a humble thing to do. Let's just take a moment to do some self-examination, and we'll come back and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, God, for coming up with this incredible plan of salvation, to send the sinless, spotless Lamb of God, your Son, Jesus Christ, into this world. And we thank you, Jesus, for being willing to lay down your life on a cruel cross and to have my sins placed on you. In fact, the sins of the whole world, all of those who trust in you, in faith. We thank you, God, for the sacrifice. We thank you for the blood that was spilled, for the salvation that you purchased. And we thank you that 3 days later, Jesus Christ rose again from the grave, sealing the victory. O death, where is your sting? O grave, where is your victory? What an amazing God we serve. We also believe, God, that there is provision for our healing through the blood of Jesus. And Father, I pray for all that need a physical touch from you, that you would touch them, Lord. We pray for Pastor Don, God, that you bring healing to him, that you continue to touch Pastor Billy, Lord, and several others, Father, that need a healing touch from you. Just declare your healing power right now in the name of Jesus. Father, we ask your blessing upon these emblems now as we partake in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's partake of the bread together. Let's partake of the cup. Let's just begin once again to give thanks to the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Someday, folks, we're going to get to do this with Jesus himself in heaven. And that's going to be an amazing, amazing day. Amen. Amen. Well, if you have your Bible with you or a device with you, I'm going to have you turn, please, to James chapter 4. And while you're doing that, I want to say I wish a happy birthday to couple of very special people in my life, and they're not here. First of all, 2 days ago, my mother celebrated her 80th birthday, 80 years young, and she is full of energy, and she loves the Lord, and she's been a great mom. So happy birthday, Mom. I know you're watching. And I also want to wish a very happy birthday to my son, Nathaniel, who will be celebrating his birthday in 2 days. And this is the last year that Nate is going to be single digits, turning 9. And Nate, I just want to let you know, buddy, I love you so much. And you have a very, very special place in my heart. And I'm so glad that God put you in our family. And happy birthday. And I look forward to celebrating that with you in a couple of days. Amen. Amen. Well, we've been working our way through the book of James, and we're looking for principles to live by during a pandemic. Just one other announcement before we move on. It looks as though we will be able to gather again in person next Sunday morning.
Amen.
Amen. And we're going to have an official announcement regarding that. But I believe it's on Tuesday. We go out of the official lockdown and back into the COVID color framework. And so it looks though as though here on Perth is going to be in orange. That's good news for us. We get to gather as a body of believers again. It's also good news for the small businesses in our community and in our county. And we just want to pray that God would just wipe this thing off the face of the earth. Amen. Amen. And we're looking forward to having everybody back together again. Family of God belongs together.
Yes.
Amen. Now, the book of James is a very practical book. It's been challenging me. I've said this over and over again in this series. I've been preaching to myself, and the Holy Spirit is doing a work in me through this. I've discovered that there are areas in my heart that I need to surrender to God, to let go, and to let God. And so far, we've covered a lot of ground. Now, I can't believe it. This is the 17th message in the book of James. James is about having the kind of faith that works when life doesn't work. He was writing to people who were going through an intense period of persecution. And so they were under major stress at that time. And the principles apply to us who are under major stress during this pandemic. The book of James has a lot to say about these very practical areas of your life. And if you've missed any of these messages, I want to encourage you to go to our website, freshmanchurch.net, click the watch tab, just scroll down and you'll find all these messages under current series on demand. And you can just click them and watch them right there on the website. You can also watch them on our YouTube channel as well. So if you missed any of it, you can go back and listen or watch these previous messages. And every message dealt with a different emotional problem. That's what the first part of the book of James deals with, the antidotes to the emotional stress and distress that we've all been feeling. In the middle of the book, he moves to advice about interpersonal stress. And he starts talking about how to improve our relationships, even in stressful times that increase conflict. So we've done some messages on relationships. We talked about how God wants us to plant seeds of peace. We talked about de-escalating conflict and handling delays patiently. And a biggie, filtering what we say, being more merciful. And then last time, we talked about staying hopeful in the midst of a pandemic. Now today we're going to continue to study how to improve relationships, even in the middle of difficult times, because when we're tired, when we're fatigued, when we're under long-term stress, it often brings out the worst in us. We can become irritable, And we can become touchy. We can become rude. And I'll tell you, you see rudeness almost every time you go to the grocery store. You can become demanding and you can become judgmental of others. And that's why James comes back a second time to deal with the issue of not judging others. And so we're calling this message today, A Faith That Keeps Me From Playing God. James chapter 4, verses 11 and 12. Let me read it to you. It says, "Brothers and sisters, do not slander one another. Anyone who speaks against a brother or sister or judges them speaks against the law and judges it. When you judge the law, you are not keeping it, but sitting in judgment on it. There is only one lawgiver and judge, the one who is able to save and destroy. But you, who are you to judge your neighbor?" May God add his blessing today to the reading of his word. Now, that's a pretty straightforward passage, and we're just going to take these two verses and look at the implications today. Now, what I want to do today is answer three important questions. Number one, why are we so quick to judge others? Why? Well, in that passage that I just read, it indicates that there's two reasons why we tend to be judgmental of others. I'm going to give them to you real quick today. First of all, guilt. Guilt. Okay? We judge others because we feel guilty. And I want you to write this down. We want to excuse our own failures. Adam was the first man that God created. And he fell into sin. And what he did two things. He excused his own sin, and he accused Eve of being the cause of his sin. And ever since that time, it's been human nature to accuse and excuse. To accuse and excuse. We make excuses for our own behavior, and we accuse others of something worse. Now, that doesn't work. But that's where judgment comes from, when we feel guilty. Romans chapter 2, verses 3 and 4 says, "Since you judge others for doing these things, why do you think you can avoid God's judgment when you do the same things?" Now, the Message paraphrase of that verse says this very interestingly. It says, "You didn't think, did you, that just by pointing your finger at others, you would distract God from seeing all your misdoings and from coming down on you hard? Or did you think that because he's such a nice God, he'd let you off the hook?" Anytime you hear a leader or a politician or anybody else condemning or judging the attitudes or the behaviors of other people, then you can be sure that they are hiding things in their own life that they don't want judged. It's a diversion. It's a cover-up. They're trying to take all of the attention off of their own obvious faults that they feel guilty about, but it doesn't work. So we judge other people because we want to get the guilt off of us, we want to distract, and we want people to think about other people, not us. The second reason we're quick to judge is this: pride. Pride. And you can write this down. We want to feel superior to other people. Now, you need to be sure that whenever you see a person who is always criticizing, they're always judging, they're always trash talking, you can be sure that they feel pretty insecure in their life. And so they try to puff themselves up by putting other people down. Now, people who are secure in their own identity, they don't need to back off other people to feel better about themselves. So guilt causes us to judge others. Pride causes us to judge others. Now, the worst form of pride is religious pride and spiritual pride. And the Bible calls this the sin of self-righteousness. You see, real Christ-like faith makes you humbler, gentler. But self-righteous faith makes you arrogant, stubborn, critical, and judgmental. You know people like that. And you and I, if we're going to be honest, have been guilty of doing that ourselves. By the way, this is why people gossip. They want to feel better than other people. It's why they read the gossip magazines. It's why they watch TV shows like TMZ and Entertainment Tonight. And they get a perverse pleasure in reading about the downfall and the problems of other people because they think it helps make them feel better. And you need to know that God condemns all gossip. Gossipers are both prideful and insecure. And by the way, you can be certain that people who gossip to you are also gossiping about you. Guaranteed. If they gossip to you, they're gossiping about you. So you should not listen to the gossip. It's stolen goods. So these are the reasons, guilt and pride, why we tend to be judgmental of others. Now here's the second question I want us to look at this morning. Why should I not judge others? Why should I not judge others? And James in chapter 4 points out three reasons. First, judging others is unloving. You can't love somebody and judge them at the same time. It's the opposite. Judging is the opposite of Jesus' great commandment, which James, by the way, calls the royal law. The great commandment is the royal law. Love your neighbor as yourself. You can't do that. You can't act loving towards somebody while you're judging them at the same time. I remember a little while ago we covered James 2 verse 8, where James says, if you really keep the royal law found in Scripture, love your neighbor as yourself, you're doing right. You're doing the right thing. It's always the right thing to love your neighbor as yourself. Now a couple chapters later in chapter 4, he adds these words in verse 11. Anyone who speaks against a brother or sister or judges them speaks against the law and judges it. And when you judge the law, you're not keeping it, but you're sitting in judgment on it. Now, what law? What law? The royal law. Love your neighbor as yourself. And he says, you're breaking the great commandment every time you judge. I once heard a story about a woman who told her pastor, Pastor, I have the gift of criticism. Now, of course, that's not a spiritual gift in the Bible. So the pastor said, well, ma'am, that is one talent that you should go out and bury it. Go out and bury the gift of criticism. So judging others is unloving. Secondly, James says that judging others is God's job, not mine. It's God's job. It's not my job. And he points this out in the next verse, verse 12. And here's what he says. There's only one lawgiver and judge, the one who is able to save and destroy. And now the word lawgiver is used only five times in the Bible. It's used four times in the Old Testament and this one time in the New Testament. God is the only true lawgiver and judge, and he alone has the authority to save or destroy. And at the end of verse 12, he says, but you, who are you to judge your neighbor? Now, I want you to write this down because this is the whole message in a single sentence. You ready? Anytime I judge other people, I'm playing God. All right? I want you to write that down. Anytime I judge other people, I'm playing God. I'm putting myself in God's place, and I'm taking the responsibility of judging others on myself. But there's only one lawgiver and one judge. So anytime I judge other people, I'm playing God. And that is one game that you should never play, playing God. Now, Paul says the same thing in Romans 14. Romans 14, verse 4. Who are you to condemn someone else's servants? Their own master will judge whether they stand or fall. And with the Lord's help, they will stand and receive his approval. So if I look at you and I judge you, God says to me, they're not your servant, Gilbert. They're my servant. They're the Lord's servant, and I will judge them, not you, says the Lord. So judging others is unloving. Judging others is God's job and not mine. And a third, the game says that judging others is unchristian. We call ourselves Christians. Well, Christians are to be like Christ. Now, remember, James is writing to Christian believers, and he says in that verse, this verse on judgmentalism, my brothers and sisters, see, Christians are supposed to be like Jesus, but we can't be like Jesus when we're judging others. John 3, verse 17 says this, God sent his Son into the world, not to judge the world, but to save the world through him. Now, if we want to be like Jesus, we need to stop judging the world and start trying to save the world by pointing them to Jesus Christ. So it's unloving. It's God's job. He says it's unchristian. And every time I judge somebody, I'm not being like Christ. I'm going to take this a little step further. You ready? Preaching hard today. In fact, the Bible says Satan is the accuser of the brethren. He's the accuser of believers. That's his name. He is the source of all damning accusations, because in Christ there is no condemnation. So Satan is the source of all damning accusations, and he accuses you all the time. Ready? When you start accusing other people, you're just doing Satan's job for him. You ever thought about that before? He's the accuser. And Satan says, thank you very much. You go ahead and accuse that other believer. Accuse that other church or whatever. One of the biggest mistakes that people make is we condemn the whole life, the whole personality of somebody just for one small action that we've been disapproving of, and we generalize and we categorize people too quickly, and we see one thing over here that we don't like, and then we write them off. I mean, that happened just this week with a lady who was on a Disney Plus television show. She put something on her Facebook that the producers didn't like, and they canned her, fired her. God says that this doesn't work, accusing. It's unchristian. Now, we get to the point of what I really want to deal with, and this is the third question. How can I learn to be less judgmental? Particularly during this COVID-19 crisis, when everybody's under stress and everybody's tired and everybody's at the end of their rope. You tend to be, when you're not feeling that good, when you're tired, when things aren't going your way, you tend to start being judgmental. So why? Probably caught yourself doing that over the last months. So I want to suggest to you several things from God's word in the time remaining to remember. If you'll remember these things, they will help you break the habit of being so judgmental of people. So remember these things from God's word. Number one, you need to remember that I'm not the standard. And that's going to help us a whole lot. I'm not the standard. But when I set myself up as the standard, I get judgmental. 2 Corinthians 10, verse 12. Of course, we would not dare classify ourselves or compare ourselves with those who rate themselves so highly. How stupid they are. They make up their own standards to measure themselves by, and they judge themselves by their own standards. You and I, we are not the standard of perfection. Yet when we judge, we're really using ourselves as the standard. Remember, God is the standard. Secondly, when you get ready to judge somebody, I need to remember that I don't know the whole story. I don't know the whole story. I don't know the hurts. I don't know the crisis. I don't know the limitations. I don't know the background. I'm just seeing the behavior. I'm looking at how far they need to come rather than how far they've already come. And there's a big difference there. Don't look at where people need to go. Look at how far they've come. Proverbs 18 and verse 13 says, spouting off before listening to the facts is both shameful and foolish. So we need to make sure that we have the whole story. John 7, verse 24, Jesus said, stop judging by external standards. Because when you look at external standards, you look at the outward behavior, you don't know the whole story. So don't have all the facts. And I'm not the standard by which the world gets judged. All right, third, I need to remember that I never know anyone's motivation. I never truly know anyone's motivation. And anytime we judge somebody's motivation, it's foolishness. Why? Because we don't know our own motivation much of the time. So much of the time, I can't even understand why I do what I do. And if I can't figure out my own motivation half the time, who am I to judge the motivation of others? I don't know anybody's motivation. That's nonsense. Nobody has the ability to read minds. Nobody has the ability to see inside a person's heart. Only Jesus Christ can do that. Only the Holy Spirit can do that. Only God the Father can do that. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 11 says, no one can know a person's thoughts except that person's own spirit. And no one can know God's thoughts except God's own spirit. I should not judge because there's no way that I can know your motivation. And there's no way that you can know mine. No one really knows what someone else is thinking or what they're really like except that person themselves. Check out 1 Corinthians 4, verse 5. It says, therefore, judge nothing before the appointed time. Wait until the Lord comes. He will bring to light what is hidden in darkness and will expose the motives of the heart. And at that time, each will receive their praise from God. So depending on the fact that God knows my motivation, God knows your motivation, but nobody else does. So remember, you don't know all the facts, you don't know all the motives, so don't judge. Number four, I need to remember that I have blind spots that I can't see. Okay? Now, we all have blind spots in our lives, and the fact that they're called blind spots means that I can't see them. Now, maybe you can see my blind spots, but I can't see them. And maybe I can see your blind spots, but you can't. We can't see our own, and that's why we need each other. Well, the fourth reason to not be judgmental, to not be so quick to judge, is that I have blind spots that I can't see. Now, Jesus talked about this in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 7, which is in that middle of that sermon, verses 3 to 5, Jesus says, and why worry about a speck in your friend's eye when you have a log in your own? How can you think of saying to your friend, let me help you get rid of that speck in your eye when you can't see past the log in your own eye? Hypocrite. First, get rid of the log in your own eye, and then you will see well enough to deal with the speck in your friend's eye. Now, if you look at this passage in the wording, Jesus is using some Hebrew humor of exaggeration to make a point. But the idea is this. We tend to judge other people's faults, but we can't see what's going on in our own life. My own faults, my own failures. You see, that's my blind spot. Jesus says, remove the log in your eye. Then maybe you'll be able to clearly see to help others. Now, what's ironic is that we tend to judge in others what we dislike in ourselves. See, if you're lazy and you know it, you don't like that about you, you tend to judge other people lazy. You see it in others. If you're prideful, you tend to spot pride in others quickly. If you're greedy, you tend to spot greed in other people. Whatever you yourself struggle with, whether it's fear or worry or anger or anxiety, you tend to notice that in others quicker. And if you see somebody react violently to some certain sin, well, it might be that that's the one that they're dealing with. Maybe out of secret guilt or out of fear of being found out. Broke my heart this week when the report came out about a man that I loved and admired, Ravi Zacharias. Beware ye lest you think ye stand, the Bible says. And after I cried and the shock wore off, I found myself praying, keep me true, Lord Jesus. And it's pressing me further into the presence of God. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 31. This is a powerful verse, and I want you to listen to this, to see it. If we judged ourselves in the right way, God would not judge us. Do you hear that verse? 1 Corinthians 11, 31. If we judged ourselves in the right way, in other words, if we were able to get a true evaluation of ourselves, examine ourselves, and we're God-level honest, we're honest with ourselves, we're honest to God, if we judged ourselves in that way, God would not judge us. I want you to think about that verse for just a second. Realize what the Bible is saying. It's saying if we would seriously examine our own lives, where we've got blind spots, and we would evaluate them, we would judge our own sins, we would do self-judgment of our own weakness, of our own faults, our own failures, and if we were able to do that, God said, I wouldn't have to judge you. That ought to change the way we think about our own blind spots. So let me give you a couple more things. Number 5. I need to remember to listen first. Okay? You can't be judgmental if you're truly trying to listen compassionately, honestly, sincerely, fairly. Now, how many times in this series have we quoted this next verse? James 1, verse 19. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Quick to listen. Listen first before you judge. At one time, the Pharisees were trying to judge Jesus without even letting him have a say, without even letting him explain himself, without even hearing his side of the story. And so Nicodemus, who was, by the way, a Pharisee, spoke up. And in John 7, verse 51, Nicodemus says this to the Pharisees who were trying to judge Jesus without even letting Jesus speak. John 7, 51 says, does our law condemn a man first without hearing him to find out what he's been doing? How many times have you judged your child, your son, your daughter, without listening to their story first? That's still true today. You cannot judge people before listening to them and hearing what they've done. So before you go judging somebody in your family or in your business or in your church or in your small group, you need to talk to them, you need to listen to them, you need to hear them out, and you need to let them explain themselves. And if you don't do that, you're committing the sin of judgmentalism. That leads me to the next thing I want to mention. I need to remember that I'm going to be judged by the standard that I used. That's a good spot to insert a uh-oh. That's a good reason to not be judgmental. I'm going to be judged by the standard that I use. Jesus said this very quickly, clearly. Matthew 7, verses 1 to 2. Do not judge, or you too will be judged. For the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Paul says the exact same thing. Romans chapter 14, beginning of verse 10. So why do you condemn another believer? Why do you look down on another believer? Remember, we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. Then down to verse 12. Yes, each of us will give a personal account to God. So I'm going to stop there for a second. There's going to be a judgment someday. And the only one who can judge fairly and perfectly is God. And each and every single one of us are going to have to give an account of ourselves to God. Verse 12 and then into verse 13. So let's stop condemning each other. Decide instead to live in such a way that you will not cause another believer to stumble and fall. Now, how is God going to judge people? Two ways, truthfully and impartially. And God has the right to judge because first, he's the authority, he's the lawgiver, but he always judges truthfully, not based on opinion, but based on his word, based on the truth. And he judges impartially. God is not prejudiced. He's not biased. Now, today there's a lot of prejudice. People can't get justice in the courts. And if you are rich, you can get off a lot easier than having to go to jail and all kinds of things. And there's partiality in our justice system for all kinds of things, for economics and race and all kinds of things. But you can be sure that on judgment day, when God judges, it will be truthful and it will be impartial. And this is why God is the only one who has the right to judge us, because he's always completely true and completely impartial. Here's the last thing I want to leave you. Biggest reason of all for me to not be judgmental, because I need to remember how God has shown me his grace. See, if I got what I deserved, folks, I wouldn't even be standing here. You wouldn't even be taking your next breath. God has shown me and shown you grace and mercy. A couple of weeks back, we looked at James 2:13 with that phrase, mercy triumphs over judgment. And the whole message was about mercy. Grace is getting what we don't deserve, and mercy is not getting what we do deserve. And we ought to be grateful for the fact that God says mercy triumphs over judgment. Love that. Now, I don't read this translation of the scripture too often. I do consult it when I'm studying. But I love this verse, Ephesians 2, verse 8, in the Amplified Version. Here it is. For it is by grace, God's remarkable compassion and favor drawn you to Christ, that you have been saved, actually delivered from judgment and given eternal life through faith. And this salvation is not of yourselves, not through your own effort, but it is the undeserved, gracious gift of God. Amen. I want to ask you, have you received that salvation? Because if you haven't, then you're stuck in your guilt. You're still stuck in judgment because you're either living under grace or you're living under judgment. You've either have accepted everything Jesus Christ did on the cross by paying for all your sins, or you're planning to pay for your sins yourself. See, somebody's got to pay for all the stuff that we've done wrong in our lives. And you can either pay for it yourself, or you can accept God's grace and mercy, and then you pass from death into life without the judgment. And it means you go scot-free. It means you get a clean slate. And you say, that's not fair, but you're right, it's not fair, it's grace. Grace is not fair. In fact, if God gave us what we deserve, none of us would go to heaven. Heaven is perfect and we're not. So if you've not accepted the grace of God, you need to do it now. It's by God's grace you have been saved, and that's how you get your salvation. And even that's not of yourself. It's a gift from God. You just put your faith in God's grace. That's what you do. There's nothing that you yourself can do to get yourself saved. If you haven't done that, it would be my honor to help you step across that line right now. You don't need to go through life under condemnation. God doesn't want you walking around feeling guilty for all the stuff that you've done wrong. He wants you to accept his grace and to accept his mercy and accept what Jesus Christ did on the cross and what he sealed by rising again on the third day. So I want to say two prayers this morning. I want to pray a prayer for those of you who've never invited Christ into your life, made him the Lord of your life. I want you to invite him to forgive you and to start living under his grace rather than under condemnation and judgment. And then I want to pray for the rest of us who've already made that decision. And when I pray, I'm going to ask God to help us to be a little less judgmental and a little more gracious to others. When you fully understand grace, you want to be gracious to others. When you realize how much slack God has cut you, then you want to give it to others. And when you find somebody who's judgmental, you realize that they don't really understand grace because they think they're still living under law. Like they need to get God's approval by what they do. There's an old hymn that says, Jesus paid it all. Let's bow our heads and let me lead you into prayer. If you've never invited Jesus Christ into your life, please say this after me. Something like this. Dear God, I know I've done a lot of wrong things in my life, and I deserve to be judged for them. I want to turn away from those sins. And I know I can't pay for them. But thank you, Jesus Christ, for paying for my sins on the cross. I don't understand it all, but I do understand that you have a free gift of your grace and mercy. And that's the only way I can be saved and go to heaven, be delivered from the judgment. So today, I'm putting whatever faith I've got in your promise to forgive me, to change me, to cleanse me, to make me a new person. I know I could never earn this or work for it. So Jesus, I'm saying yes to your grace. I'm saying yes to your mercy. And I want to move from judgment into life. Humbly ask this in your name. Amen. I want to pray a second prayer. And that's for those of us who've already stepped across the line and that we've given our hearts to Jesus Christ. My prayer will be that we would not be known as judgmental people, but as gracious and merciful people. So I'm going to invite you just to bow your heads and pray along with me in your heart. Heavenly Father, when I start to judge other people, help me to remember that judging others is unloving. Help me to remember that it's your job, not mine. But I'm playing God every time I judge somebody and criticize them. Help me to remember, Lord, that judging others is unchristian. And that, Jesus, you didn't come to judge the world. You came to save the world. And I want to be like you. Help me to point people to you instead of pointing people to judgment. I can't love people and judge them at the same time. And Lord, when I start to be judgmental, help me to look and say, is this guilt in my own life or is it pride? Or am I just using this to excuse my own failures? God, forgive me for that. Lord, help me to remember these things that I might be more like Jesus. Help me to remember that I'm not the standard. But I'm not to make up the standard of the world. But I'm not perfect. Help me to remember that I don't know the whole story, that I don't know all the facts, that there's God's side and that there's people's sides. Help me to be humbler. Help me to remember I don't know anybody's motivation. And when I start to judge their motivation, help me to remember that I don't even know my own half of the time. Help me to remember that I have blind spots that I can't see instead of focusing on getting a speck out of somebody else's eye. Lord, I thank you for the promise that if we judge ourselves in the right way, you would not judge us. So help me to make self-evaluation and personal examination of my own sins a regular habit in my life so that you don't have to judge me. Help me to remember before I judge somebody to listen first. That according to God's law, we cannot judge people before listening to them and hearing what they've done. I have to admit, Lord, that it scares me that I will be judged by the same standard I use. So help me to be more loving and more gracious and more merciful, more forgiving. Help me to remember if I judge other people, if I accuse other Christians, that I'm doing the work of the devil. Please forgive me for the time I've done the devil's work. And bad-mouthing other Christians. Lord, most of all, help me to remember how much grace you've shown me. When I remember that, that I would be gracious to other people, that I would be as forgiving as others of others as you've forgiven me, and as merciful to others as you've been merciful to me. I don't want to be judged by my standard. I want to be under your grace. And I thank you, Father, that there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Folks, I want to thank you for hanging in there today. Went a little longer than normal. If you gave your heart to the Lord today, if you made the decision to become a follower of Christ, I would love for you to get in touch with me. You can email me at pastorjason@hurontal.on.ca. I check that email every day. I will respond to you. I want to encourage you and be a blessing to you in your first steps as a new believer. Or if you want to get in touch with me about some prayer requests, I would love to do that and pray with you. And also, out of gratitude to the Lord, we give. And the most convenient way that we can do that during these times is by e-transfer. It's simple. Those of you who do online banking, you just log into your online bank and you can just follow the steps there to send along an e-transfer. fwrcdonation@gmail.com. That is a safe and secure way for funds to get to us. We are doing our best to do the work of the Lord here in Wingham, and his work needs to be financed. And God commands us to give tithes and offerings, and we do so not out of duty, but out of gratitude to him. He's a great God. He's blessed us. And so let's continue to be a blessing to the work of the Lord here at Fresh Wind. Thank you for watching this morning. The Lord bless you. I hope you enjoy the rest of your day. Happy Valentine's Day, everybody. God bless.